Assalamu alaikum viewers, in today's lecture we will discuss about crystal field theory, and this is the updated and summarized version of this theory, and today we will discuss its part 1. The links of PDF files used in this video are given in description. So first of all, we shall see that what are the main postulates of this theory. This theory was presented by Beth and Van Vleck in 1930. The main focus of this theory is that there is only electrostatic or ionic interaction exists between metal and ligand, and there is no such thing which is of coordinate covalent nature or covalent nature. So this is the very fundamental point of this theory, and that is why the word crystal has been inserted in the name of this theory, because crystal means ionic compounds. And this theory suggests that there is only electrostatic or ionic interaction between metal and ligand, and there is no coordinate covalent bond or other such thing. What happens actually, that metal has a positive charge whereas ligand has negative charge, so both these attract each other through electrostatic or ionic interaction. So here question comes that if a ligand is neutral, then how come it is possible that it is attracted towards the metal? If ligand is neutral, then there are some elements which are more electronegative in nature, so due to that electronegative nature of that particular element, the ligand will be attracted towards the metal. The main focus of this theory is the central metal atom or ion. So next point is that although there is a bond between the metal and ligand, and that bond is ionic in nature, but this theory mainly focuses on metal rather than on ligands. In case of metals atom or ion, the only focus is on the metal d orbital, while other orbitals are not discussed. So as we have seen in the valence bond theory, there are s and p orbitals are also involved in hybridization and bond formation, whereas this theory suggests that only d orbital is involved, whereas this theory don't discuss any s or p orbital. Next point is, according to this theory, splitting of d orbital or loss in their degeneracy is the driving force behind the stability of coordination complexes. So what happens, that metal attract to, or the ligands are attracted towards the metal, and once they are closely approach each other, then what happens, that d orbital of the metal splits, and some orbital goes high in energy and some goes low in energy, or we can say that there is overall loss in their degeneracy, and this loss in degeneracy or d orbital splitting is the driving force behind the stability of coordination complexes. Now here question comes that what thing made this d orbital split into different levels, or how their degeneracy is lost. Then next point is, d orbital splitting or loss in their degeneracy is occurring due to the electrostatic repulsions between the electrons of metals and ligands. So here what is happening, that metal attracts ligand towards their self. So what happens when they come so close to each other, then the electrons of metal and electrons of ligands, they feel repulsions, and when they feel repulsions, and then as a result of which the metal d orbital splits, and some d orbitals go into high in energy and some go into lower energy level. So as a result of which their overall degeneracy is lost, or we can say that d orbital is split, and this splitting or degeneracy loss is the driving force behind the stability of the coordination complexes. So it means, in order to further understand this theory, we have to actually study the original shapes of d orbitals, which are quite dissimilar from each other, unlike s and p orbital. But before we go into the shapes of the d orbitals, first we summarize all the postulates in this analogical diagram. So if we say here, this is the electronic cloud of the free metal ion, and in this diagram it has been considered just like a sponge ball. Now in this diagram, if we see there, that these arrows are actually the ligands that are approaching towards the central metal atom or ion. Now question is, why these ligands are attracted towards the metal? Obviously metal has positive charge whereas ligand has negative charge, so as a result of which they are attracted towards the metal. So as these attract towards the metal, so they exert force, and what this force does is that it do electrostatic repulsions between the electrons of metal and between the electrons of ligands. As a result of these repulsions, the d orbital which is shown here in this sphere is d-shaped, and this d-shaping is represented here. As we see that ligand put a force on the d electronic cloud, and as a result of which it distorts, and it distorts in a way that there are two types of regions formed in this d orbital. These regions which are doesn't come into the way of the ligands, so these are not directly interacting with the ligand, so these make a region of low energy. Whereas these regions where the ligands are approaching towards the metal ion, so these regions feel more repulsions, and these are actually high energy regions of the d orbital. So that is why when these ligands approach each other, it creates or splits the d orbital, and it splits into two types. First region is the low energy region, where the second region is the high energy region. Low energy region represents that where the ligands are not coming directly towards the metal atom or ion, whereas the regions where the ligands are directly approaching towards the metal d cloud, so from that positions the d orbital goes high in energy. So this low in energy and high energy ultimately splits the d orbital, or we can say that there is happening of a degeneracy lost, and this degeneracy lost or splitting of d orbital is the reason behind the bonding of coordination complexes. So in this diagram we explain the different shapes of the d orbitals. So unlike s and p orbital, the d orbitals are different in shape and geometry. So if we see here, there are two sets of d orbitals. One, this set is called as on the axis d orbitals, whereas the other set is called as in between the axis orbitals. If we see here, this is the geometry of d z square. If you see that one lobe of d orbital is along z axis and the other lobe has surrounded this z axis, so that is why the name comes d z square. Whereas in this, one lobe is along x axis and the other lobe is perfectly lying on the y axis. So at both lobes are existing on x and y axis, so this orbital is called as dx square y square. As both these orbitals are actually lying exactly on the axis, so that is why these orbitals are called as on the axis d orbitals. Whereas the other set of orbitals, which is dxy, dyz and dxz, these orbitals are called as in between the axis, because here the d orbital is actually lying in between the axis and not exactly on the axis. So if we see here that this d orbital is actually lying in between the x and y plane, whereas this d orbital is lying in between the x and z plane, whereas this d orbital is lying along the y and z plane, but it is not lying exactly on the axis but in between the axis. So that is why these three orbitals are called as in between the axis orbitals, whereas these two orbitals are called as along the axis or on the axis orbitals. Now as we have seen the analogy of how the d orbital splits and it goes into high energy and low energy levels, and by visualizing this analogy, and also we have seen the different shapes of the d orbital like dxy, dyz and dxz and dx square, y square and dz square. Now we are ready to see our first crystal field splitting diagram for octahedral geometry. So as we see here, there is the energy parameter. As we go high, it means we are going high in energy. So this is the metal which is placed here, and these are the 5d orbitals of this metal, and these 5d orbitals are placed here, and these have not split still because ligands have not made a bond here at this position. Now these all go towards high energy as ligand approach. So here only the metal ion is present, and here the metal and ligands are present, but actually at this stage there is no bond formed between the metal and ligand. Just ligands are approaching towards the metal at this stage. So the whole electronic cloud of d orbital is in high energy, but here the splitting has not taken place yet. So splitting has taken place yet here in this position, and in this position actually metal and ligand bond has been formed, and this metal and ligand bond has been formed, and its geometry is actually the octahedral geometry as seen here. So in octahedral geometry, as we see here, there are six ligands, and these ligands are coming exactly along the axis. So as a result of which, what happens that this d orbital splits into two sets. First set is of dx square, y square and dz square, and this set has gone into higher energy because it comes directly into the path of the incoming ligand. So there happens a lot of interaction between the electrons of metal and between the electrons of ligands, and these interactions or electrostatic repulsions, the d orbital dx square, y square and dz square becomes high in energy, whereas the in between the axis orbitals like dxy, dyz and dxc, these feel less repulsion as these are not coming directly in the path of the incoming ligand. So these feel less repulsion and they become low in energy. So the 5d x square y square dz square dxy dyz and dz key that were at the same level here, these orbitals have been separated into two sets. The on the axis orbitals go high in energy, whereas in between the axis orbitals become less in energy and become low in energy. These dx square y square and dz square orbitals are represented by eg, whereas dxy dyz and dxc orbitals are represented by t2g. This is the group theoretical term for which is derived as on the basis of the shapes of these orbitals. So what is important here is to note del o. Del o is called as crystal feed splitting parameter for octahedral geometry, o for octahedral. So this splitting of orbitals is the reason or the driving force behind the formation of this coordination complex. How this splitting is responsible for the driving or the is the driving force behind the stability of the coordination complexes, this I shall explain in the next incoming lecture. Thank you. Allah Hafiz.